to worship.
It is, as usual, a little different today. I miss all of you. I can see your chairs, your seats, your designated places, and I know you're there in spirit with me. I will give you a little advice, though. There are advantages to the fact that you get to worship electronically instead of being here. One of them is that you can worship in your pajamas. Number two is that you can get your coffee cup refilled anytime you want. And number three, you don't have to sit in the same place all the time. You can move around. And fourthly, whenever you want, you can mute the preacher. Good morning and welcome all of you who are with us electronically this morning. Our rock of refuge, our strong fortress. God saves us among wickedness and cruelty.
Hope in God who has created you. Open yourself to the one who knows you well.
God accepts us even when people do not. God affirms us even when we fail. We have come to embrace the mysteries of our faith. We are here to worship the God who empowers us.
Today's modern lesson is a reflection on Dorothy Stang, an American Catholic nun who was murdered in 2005 while she was very much dedicated to protecting the rainforest. She oftentimes was wearing a shirt and portrait. The death of the forest is the end of our lives. There is scarcely an American Catholic over 45, who didn't know Sister Dorothy Stang. That is, they've known the archetypical, cheerful, pancake-making, ice cream eating, can-do, go-getting U.S. nun with the ready smile and the willingness to help, who could stand as firm as the Rock of Gibraltar when justice for the poor was threatened, and organize faster than governments can move. It takes a strong faith and a strong prayer life to do that in the United States. It requires a rarer form of Christian courage to do so in a far place. They said at the burial of Sister of Notre Dame de Namur, Dorothy Stang, in Anapu, Brazil, that she was not buried, she was planted in Brazil's soil. Brazil's ambassador to Washington said at the memorial service, her seeds already have shoots. He was referring to Brazil's commitment to speak through the pending legislation for two enormous tracts of land for sustainable development for poor farmers. And yet, when Dorothy Stang's blood seeped into the earth from her gunshot wounds, it did more than plant her deeds in memory in Brazil. It bonded her to more than a century of women religious from the United States who left their homes and learned new languages in order to understand the culture of the larger family they had come to serve in the four corners of the world. Some died in wars and uprisings. Some died at peace at a great age. Others wasted away from disease too rapid to cure or too far from the medicine that might have saved them. All these churchwomen died as they had lived and served, thousands of miles away from home. Most would be satisfied that the final remains would be in those places they had been privileged to serve. Places where these women knew that the blessing was something they received being there. They, too, were planted. Their seedlings are strong bulwarks of faith committed to change and justice. Certainly, the Dorothy Stangs of America are fewer now. Where once there were many hundreds, there are now but a few score, a few dozen. They are, along with the priests and the brothers in light and lay volunteers, fine representatives of the best of the U.S. Catholic Church has to offer the world. Stang understood as life was blown from her by violence, and she said, "Blessed are the poor. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for justice. Blessed are the peacemakers."
Shall we pray? O holy God, there are few bodies present this morning, but there are many spirits. This room is filled with the memories of the songs sung, the prayers offered, the sermons preached, the folks that found hope and joy and love in this place fill the building even when they are not present. We come this morning with anxiety, with trepidation, with pain, because we see around us so many ways in which things are not going as planned, as hoped, as dreamed, as wished. We are afraid for what the future holds, and we are afraid for ourselves and our neighbors. We're afraid for our neighbors, even those we've never met around the world. We come, though, with assurance that we are not alone, that you are here, very present with us, present here at Uplands, present in our state and in our world, and we give you thanks. Holy God, this morning we lift up to you, especially in prayer, Mary Nellie's daughter, who is dying. We ask that you would comfort her, since she can receive very little physical comfort from us. Please embrace her with your love and compassion so that she might find some peace. We ask you to be with the many individuals of Italy who today are quarantined as the death toll there rises as much as 25% per day. We ask, too, God, that you would be with all the workers in hospitals and nursing homes and any kind of facility as they are out there in the midst of this epidemic, and they are trusting that they will come home safely and not bring home any virus to their own families. We ask you to be with them, and we give thanks for their commitment to their profession and to you. We thank you, God, this morning that we are blessed by technology to not be separated. We are not physically together, but we can still be part of worship. We can still be one with you. For where more than one of us are, there you are. We give you thanks. We ask your continued help and guidance to those who are in charge of Uplands, who are in charge of the various facilities, that they will use good prudence and they will make good decisions about what is best for us. We thank you for your continued love. And in our hearts, we lift up to you the names of those that are near and dear to us this morning. Please join me in the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Saul, I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king from among his sons.
Samuel said,
how can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me.
And God said,
take a heifer with you and say, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you.
Samuel did what God commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said,
do you
come peaceably?
Samuel said,
peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice.
And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, Samuel looked at Eliab and thought,
surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord.
But God said to Samuel,
do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart.
Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. Samuel said,
neither has God chosen this one.
Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said,
neither has God chosen this one.
Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse,
God has not chosen any of these. Are all your sons here?
Jesse said,
there remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep.
And Samuel said to Jesse,
send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here.
He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. God said,
rise and anoint him, for this is the one.
Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of God came mightily upon David from that day forth. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah.
Let us pray. O God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of our hearts be acceptable to you, God, for you are our rock. Amen. We continue this morning our discussion of the text in the Hebrew scripture that have to do with God and God's calling of the Israelites. We continue this story that we first began with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden when they have disobeyed God and they have then suffered the consequences, but God does not ever leave them. Next, we have the call of Abraham and Sarah, and they go into the wilderness where they are led by the hand of God to a land that was chosen for them, God present with them. When we come back many centuries later, we find that the Hebrews have been in the land and then lost it and have now been sent into captivity in Egypt. And in Egypt, God again delivers them, brings them out into the wilderness to show them once again to the promised land. Where they were in the desert at this time and absolutely miserable because they had no water and feared they may die. God again, though, rescues them by making water flow out of a stone cliff. Now they're settled in a new land and all should be well, but it is not. They have demanded from God that they want a king, like the other countries around them. Their prophet and judge and the main character is Samuel, and he thinks this is a very bad idea. He tries to get them to reconsider, but no, they want a king. The truth is that as long as the people of God live in the world, they will need a government that is human. God may be their king, but not without an earthly ruler. Against his better judgment, Samuel anoints Saul to be the first king of Israel. Saul is good-looking, he's smart, comes from a wealthy family. Perfect king material, right? Not so much. You would think so, but you see, Samuel forgets to listen to God. In fact, he's pretty bad at it. He makes a number of mistakes, and one big one he makes with God is that God asks him, after he has defeated the Amalekites, to sacrifice all of those he has captured. Saul decides to keep the good-looking ones, the smart ones, the king, because they might prove worthwhile to him, which meant that he sacrificed only the old, the maimed, the weak, and the poor. And this did not set well with God, because God does not like to be disobeyed. For God, it was the last straw. God was through with Saul. It was so much the last straw, that Samuel told Saul that God was not pleased with him and was unhappy about what had happened. Saul was hurt and even sad and maybe a little frightened. And Saul actually goes into a period of depression, the Bible says. Samuel hears from God in our text today about what needs to happen next. Things need to move on and we need to anoint a new king, even though Saul is still on the throne. Now, Samuel didn't want to anoint a king to begin with, and the thought that he's going to have to do another one is scary. He is afraid that Saul will also be very unhappy with him, and in fact may try to kill him. It's a reasonable fear. Saul is the kind of man who is given to brutality and shades of anger. And Samuel may be confused because God's desire for this new king has happened before Saul is gone. It is clear from the scripture, though, that the kingship of Saul has failed. And the failure is reported in the chapter right before the one that Mark read today. Saul will continue to rule for many years, but the matter has been settled. It says in chapter 15, verse 34, "For the Lord was sorry that he had made Saul king over Israel." And after David is anointed, the Spirit of God departs from Saul. Saul is depressed after Samuel tells him that God is through with him. And Samuel mourns this loss also. He may have mourned for a variety of reasons. One is, since Samuel was Saul's mentor, counselor, and spiritual advisor, Samuel may feel he failed also. It's a difficult time. Samuel is reluctant to go, but God gives him a ploy to go, gives him a way he can get there without angering Saul. It's a very interesting piece of scripture. God says, go deceive the people, say, and anoint a new king. I cannot come upon any research that I did of finding another time where God says, go deceive somebody, and I will see that it all works out well. But I challenge you this week, if you're bored, to look and come up with suggestions for me. I'm open to it. Samuel does go and do what God says. He manages the ploy. Nothing bad happens. And he looks at all of Jesse's sons, and God says no to all of them. And finally he asks Jesse, is this all of your sons? Jesse says, no, I have one more, but he's out in the field with the sheep. And they send for him. And Samuel knows that it must be that that is the anointed one that God is planning for, because Samuel says, we won't sit down to eat. And the banquet of eating would be after the anointing of the new king. So Samuel has figured out that the next son is it. And then when David appears, God says to Samuel, this is the one. Now, a lot of sermons are made up about how God sees us as we are in our hearts, that God sees what humans are like inside and therefore makes the decisions about them. I firmly believe that God can see my heart. It's a view only God has, though. God saw David's heart and decided he was the one. And God had seen Samuel's hearts many years before and saw that he was the one meant to do a certain job. And God sees our hearts just as he saw the hearts of those in our lesson today. Our strong, courageous, loving hearts are known to God. Throughout history, folks have found courage when they needed it, when it was important. We can think of courage of folks like Martin Luther King Jr., who not only put his own life on the line, but that of his wife and children. He trusted that God would help him and gave him the courage to find and become the leader of the civil rights movement. There is also Jeremiah Denton, an American prisoner of war in Vietnam, who signaled the abuse that POWs were suffering by blinking in a propaganda video the message torture in Morse code. There also is Alvin York, a World War I soldier from right here in our area of Tennessee. He stormed and took a machine gun nest and brought back 139 prisoners. And we can think of our own Dr. May, who many times must have been afraid to go into the wilderness right around here to treat folks. Folks who did not always understand her and her medicine and were, in fact, very superstitious. It took courage. Now, courage is a big word. It's a tough word. It's a word we don't like to think of ourselves as being courageous. We just can't get our heads around it. But truth is, there's a lot of good definitions for courage we might like. I chose the definition that Ernest Hemingway has. When he was asked what did he mean by guts, he said, "I mean grace under pressure." Courage or guts is what Samuel had and what all of us are going to be needing now. You may think, I don't have much courage or guts, but you do. Think back on your own life in the days ahead and you'll see what I mean. When you've taken a leap of faith for God in your life, think of that time. Maybe when you were the new kid in school and you held your head high as you walked into the classroom and all the children looked at you. Or maybe when you answered God's call to go to a foreign place and serve God's people there. Your friend said, "Why are you going? It's dangerous there." And you answered, "Because I feel God is calling me to go. I have to go." And you went. Or maybe you decide to teach in an inner city school where it was hard because many of your students were living very hard lives. Or maybe you teach or volunteer at Head Start and work with children who are not getting the love and attention they need at home. You are the presence of God for them, even if they have no name for God. Or you went to a church to serve that had been through a difficult time with their last pastor. You go and they take some of their pain out on you because you're also a pastor. And you still love them. You love them anyway. All of these are some kind of courage, the kind of courage that Samuel had, the grace under pressure that is needed to serve God and others. Right now, everywhere we look, folks are hurting. They may not have lost incomes, lost connections, maybe even lost hope. It's hard to stay positive and to not get down. But just as God helped Samuel, we are being helped by God. The usual way God helped Samuel would say, "Take a heifer and a horn of oil. Say you are going to sacrifice the Lord." The God is saying, "Be so kind and understanding, even in all these hard times, even within your own house, with the ones you love and come in contact with daily. It's not easy to be in such close quarters for an extended period. Put a smile on. Offer a prayer. Use the internet and find a funny picture or saying. I've enjoyed the many posts from my friends. One of my friends sent a picture of a video of a dog playing a piano and howling at the same time. The comment from him was, "I'll be sending cat videos next." It caused a chuckle, since I know how he feels about cat videos. Another sent a prayer for preachers today. He said, please pray for preachers who will be doing live streaming and videos this Sunday. They need to look good, not like prisoners of an Al-Qaeda video. If you're in a place where staff is helping, and I know a lot of you are, and I know you're being kind, you're being courageous, you're putting on a good face, you recognize how hard it is for them to be working under these conditions, and you offer kindness and you're polite. You make their jobs easier because you are gracious. The good news is that we are not required to find courage on our own. God provides that courage. Look around you and you will find God in all kinds of places, in all kinds of situations. I told my son I was preaching on courage today, and he gave me two thoughts. He suggested I use the Ephesians text that said, through Christ I can do all things, or the Christopher Robin quote, you're stronger than you think, you're braver than you know. So there's a lot out there. There's a lot of opportunities to find what you need. I suggest also there's much to be found in nature. We're still able to walk out in nature, to walk around our yards or our neighborhood. Go for a walk. Look at the beautiful world that is coming forth as spring happens. Look at the flowers that are bursting open, the trees that are beginning to blossom. And there are more birds even. So enjoy the spring. Rejoice the fact that we are at a quieter, more restful time. And remember, you do have all the resources you need. God sees your heart and knows all the ways. You are brave and continues to bless you. Praise be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
all-loving and gracious God, we dedicate these gifts of our church as we try to be courageous in these troubled times. May these gifts be used to further the ministries of this church, in the community, and throughout the world, as we search and long for peace and justice. Amen.
May you find courage this week. May you find joy. May you be surrounded in love. For the God is with us always. Amen.